These reasons to avoid it carefully. Manusmriti says very well, that the original words of Manusmriti appeal to us, the better. Anarogyam, anayushyam, aswargyam cha, atibhojanam, apunyam, loka vidvishtam, tasmatat parivarjaye. In Yoga Shastra texts, we find statements saying that yameshiva mitahara, among the yamas, mitahara is the best. So those, the tapasvins used to eat so less. You have all heard of the famous question of Socrates, do you live to eat or eat to live? That's the question. And for all purposes of tapas, for spiritual progress in life, one must ensure that one does not overeat. So he totally approves of the Bhagavad Gita classification of food into Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa. And H.P. Blavatsky used to call the commentary Gyaneshwari as the king of mystical works, and the work Gyaneshwari has a more detailed exposition of the classification of food into Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa, and secret doctrine endorses whatever is said in that work. And how does one eat? So even for these small things, I'll come to one beautiful quotation of Thoreau that Vadian has given on what the Indian lawgivers did. So Munu says, eat food properly, with the right attitude, with the right practice. He says, Pujaye ashanam nityam, adhya chaitat aputsayan, drishtva hrishye prasidecha, pratinandecha sarvataha, pujitam hishanam nityam, balam urjanja yachati, apujitam tudat bhuktam, ubhayam ashayetidam. Let him always, the translation given by Vadia, let him always worship his food and eat it without contempt. When he sees it, let him rejoice. Show a pleased face. Nowadays, we are all eating food in front of TV or reading the messages in the mobile and so on. On the other hand, the attitude of reverence that you must have. So you must have a pleasant face, so with no negative emotions showing on our face. And pray that he may always obtain it. Food that is always worshipped gives strength and manly vigor, but eaten irreverently, it destroys them both. So let him not give to any man what he leaves, and beware of eating in between meals. So these are all instructions given in Manusmriti. Vadia contrasts the concepts of the inner purity and the Western concept of cleanliness. Modern civilization, he says, does not recognize the real meaning and value of the kitchen in the home. The Hindu kitchen was a model. Modern knowledge aids sense life and sensuous living, but disregards soul and its needs. Inner purity is sacrificed to outer cleanliness in all things, and more, outer cleanliness is subordinated to mere appearances. So these are things that are also destroying us. Vadia is fond of quoting Bhagavad Gita and Dharmapada. He says, great books like the Gita and the Dharmapada need to be popularized. These are not sectarian books. They offer instruction to all who are athirst for the immortal waters of wisdom. And there is one interesting article called On Getting Rich. And there he quotes a beautiful Western maxim. So it's a very old one. He says, get on. Get honor, get honest. It looks like as though it's a question of orders of comparison in amongst verbs. So you have the positive degree, comparative degree, superlative degree only for adjectives. Nobody can give positive degree and comparative degree and superlative degree for verbs. But here is one statement which apparently looks like that. So he says, get on, get honor, get honest. So yes, one must earn his riches and wealth. But then one must also be mindful of being doing things in an honored manner. Get on, get honored, get honest. On the issue of hunger and happiness, he quotes the Dharmapada, which says, health is the greatest of gifts, contentment is the greatest of wealth, and trust is the best of relationships, and nirvana is the highest happiness. So many such ideas are there in earlier scriptures here also. Another interesting article is entitled, when the pupil is ready, the master appears. So there are many people who grieve that they did not get a good guru. But here he says, when the disciple is ready, the master himself appears. He refers to one statement of Shankara and shows the value of the guru. He refers to Shankara in these words, that pandit of pandits who wrote profound commentaries on the Gita, the Upanishads, the Brahma Sutras and Gaudapada's Karika and preached the magnificent philosophy of one and indivisible, the grand object of supreme realization, was a bhakta, a devotee, and he sang, there is no known comparison in all the three worlds for the venerable teacher who bestows knowledge. This is the translation of the words of Shankara. Drishtanto naiva drishtaha tribhuvana jathare sadguru jnana dhatuhu. And he has quoted more than once from Viveka Chudamani of Shankara, showing how the great influences. He says, Shanta, Shanta, Mahanto, Rivasanta Santaha, Vasantaval Lokahitam Charantaha, Tirna Swayam Bhima Bhavarnavam Janan, Hetunanyan Apikarayantaha. So, great men are so pleasing, and they are great benefactors to society, expecting nothing in return. He concludes the article by saying, when the materials are ready, the architect will appear. So when the true sadhaka is ready with his preparations, then the master or the guru will certainly appear. So he knew many details of many religions, so in sufficient closeness. He shows, for example, that the celebration of Christmas that we have is actually a pagan function. He says, he quotes from Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire and says, the Roman Christians, ignorant of the real date of the Christ's birth, fixed the solemn festival on the 25th of December, the Brumalia or the winter solstice, when the pagans annually celebrated the birth of song. So they just coincided with the program of the pagans, and therefore the real date of birth of Jesus Christ is not known. He also shows how the idea of God as light is something that is common to all the religions. So he says, the light of divinity is called the light of Christos, the light of Krishna, or of Ahura Mazda. So he gives a number of quotations from various scriptures to show how God is conceived of as light. And you can see that the source of all these, see, he says, in the Bible we read, ye are the light of the world, repeating the instruction of his predecessor, so this is the Buddha's words, be ye lamps, O bhikkhus. The Buddha said, Atta Deepa Bhavata. Atta is Atma, so Atma Deepa Ha Bhavata. In St. John's Gospel, it said, the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world, and is the light of Christos. And giving all this, he shows that all these have their origin in the Bhagavad Gita, which says, in the heart of all it ever presideth. So, Jyotisham Apita Jyotihi of the Upanishads. And even prior to that, so in the Upanishads, we have the concept of the Lord being called the Jyoti of Jyotis. In fact, MacDonald, in his History of Sanskrit Literature, says the idea of God as light. So the oldest scripture in the world that gives is the Hindu scripture. And all of the other religions have borrowed this idea from that. So the Bhagavad Gita says, Jyotisham Apita Jyotihi Tamasah Param Uchite Jnanam Jnayam Jnana Gamyam. So, there is an article in this book called Originality and Quotation. Now, he shows there how hardly can anyone be original. So, there is a witty saying in Sanskrit, Nasti Achaurah Kavijanaha. There is no poet who is not a thief. So, then every poet borrows from seeing others and earlier poets and so on. So, he shows how, what he shows excellently. In fact, I would request Ram Prakash to print that article in one of the issues of the bulletin. So, what is originality and what is quotation? So, there are some quotations from Emerson. So, Emerson says, I hate all quotations. So, tell what you can say on by your experience. And he says, even these words will be quoted. And Emerson's very witty but equally penetrating idea of what means You see, what is meant by originality? So what originality means is given in that article. So it should be a very interesting read. And he also shows how the idea of the God as light is something that is, you see, originated in the Indian scriptures. He also cautions that there should be no room for fanaticism. So he says that, and because these were the two strains of fanaticism that he found in his own days, as true as today, that, and I'm quoting his words, Wadia's words, that an Orthodox Christian or a faithful Muslim will go to heaven and men of all other creeds go to hell is crass superstition, he says. So one cannot accept such ideas as these. So while he was high reverence for all religions, he wanted to caution against this, so underlying that fanaticism of any sort is unwelcome. And he also shows how the theory of karma is present, of course, also in Hinduism and equally in Buddhism, but he says that this idea is there even in the Bible and in the Quran. Theory of karma is there in the Bible and the Quran. So he quotes from Jesus and Paul. So this is from Matthew. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. So whatever you say or do, so you'll have to pay for them. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So this is nothing but the karma theory. From the Quran, he says, the Quran also supports karma theory, he says, whatever misfortune befalleth you is sent to you by Allah for that which your hands have deserved. And therefore, he says, God supports the other scriptures. He says, the pepper plant will not give birth to roses, nor the sweet jasmine's silver star to thorn or thistle turn. So this shows the karma theory is the fundamental on which all religions are built. And he also shows how our life should be organized. This is one of the most beautiful passages. In fact, one thing that you find in the writings of Bipi Wadia is the utter simplicity and straightforwardness in presentation. How do we improve our life? There is an article called Karma and Dharma. So he says, after studying the ideas in the Bhagavad Gita and so on, he concludes like this. Acts of daily life, whether at home, at the office, or at the club, should be pure in motive, humble in execution, orderly and tidy, so that they are beautiful and helpful to the soul of everyone. Thus man becomes a perfect performer of all actions. So the stress on purity that we must have, he underlines. And once again, pointing out that there are fanatic scriptures or portions of scriptures which are fanatic, he says, but I also expect and hope that it will discard the other traditional Christian vision of God as being a jealous God. So he says, I cannot accept this. And it will reject the self-glorification of this jealous God's chosen people. So if God says that I am jealous of other gods and I have this as the chosen people, that cannot be a true God. So that there will be more than one illuminating and saving approach to the mystery of the universe. So he would not accept these things. Wadia has more than once underlined the one idea that occurs in Dhammapada. The second chapter of Dhammapada, the famous Buddhist scripture, is called Appamada Varga. It's actually Apramada Varga from Sanskrit, becomes in Pali Appamada Varga. Pramada is carelessness. So how a spiritual aspirant must be on the alert all the time is very well shown. So in Dhammapada it is said, Appamado Amatapadam Apramada, or being heedful, is one that leads to the state of Amrita. Appamado Amatam Padam Pamado Machuno Padam. Pramada is the straight road for Mrityu. Mrityu becomes Machu in Pali. So Pamado Machuno Padam. So he gives a number of quotations from that Appama or the Vagga, and ultimately you can see that the same ideas are there already in the Sanat Sujatiya portion of the Mahabharata, where he refers to that also. So there he said, Pramadam vai mrityumaham bravini. So that idea is very evident there. And even in the Kathopanishad, it is very clear. We said, apramattena vedhavyam sharavattanmayo bhave. So, pranamo dhanushyarohyatma brahmata lakshyam ucchate. Apramattena vedhavyam. One must be very attentive and one cannot be slack. So, Indians have been often accused of worshipping the forces of nature. He gives one quotation from Gayate. So Gayate says, if I am asked whether it is in my nature to revere the sun, I again say certainly, for he is likewise a manifestation of the highest being, and indeed the most powerful, which we children of earth are allowed to behold. I adore in him the light and the productive power of God, by which we all live, move and have our being, we and all the plants and animals with us. So he shows, and also continues, but if I am asked whether I am inclined to bow before the thumbstone of the apostle Peter or Paul, I say, spare me and stand off with your absurdities. So revering the sun as a veritable symbol of God and as the very originator of action and inspiration and life. So our own scriptures say, Surya Atma Jagatas Stushascha. And I would like to conclude. So he also shows how Manusmriti holds a model for us on several issues. So he quotes the words of Bhagavan Das. See, Bhagavan Das spoke these words in 1909. There is much reason to fear that modern systems of administering human society will prove a commentary on and a justification of Manu's ideals. He says, modern developments are a commentary on Manusmriti by contrast. That means, if you do not follow Manusmriti, yes, these are all the ills of society that you will beget. And therefore, understand that, he says. He quotes one verse from Manusmriti, he says, only he who knows the science of the true and all-embracing knowledge, so referring to the Vedas, only he deserves to be the leader of armies, the wielder of the rod of justice, the king of men, and the suzerain and overlord of kings. The original words of Manusmriti is Sainapatyancha Rajyancha Veda Shastra Vidarhati. So it's only the person who knows the Vedas and the Shastras that can become a commander-in-chief, and he is he who can rule the entire world. Sarva Lokadhipatyancha. So Danda Netritva Evacha. I conclude with the last words of Swadesh and Swaraj, which Wadia wrote in 1920. That's also a very beautiful article. It's a very small one, but a very telling article. So written in 1920. He says, he who has conquered himself is the master of the worlds. And when that conquest takes place, the true Swaraj is enjoyed. Then also shall we taste the joys of our true motherland, the real Swadesha, that heavenly region which is our true home. In Kannada we say, Alli de nammane, illige bande summane. So those words, those ideas are echoed here. And this is also the stand taken by Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami. So getting Swarajya, he says, is not merely political. It's only when we have the spiritual Swarajya, so our true self, then we'll have gained the real Swarajya. It's also the remarkable words of Sri Ranga Mahaguru. So with these words, I feel I have given a glimpse of some of the ideas that you can understand of Bipin Wadia. He has written a great deal about the ideas of theosophy. As this is a general audience, I have not tried to dwell upon all those intricate and abstruse ideas of theosophy. And he was a Parsi, and naturally you can expect him to have written a book on Zoroastrianism, which he has, and he has also drawn parallels of Zoroastrianism with other religions, especially the Vedic. So there are many ideas, good and grand, in even that. So, in fact, much of Zoroastrianism has a direct borrow from the Vedic. You can see, the very many mantras of Zen Avesta, or like Sanskrit mantras, with slight alterations, you can more or less derive the Avestan mantras. They were also the worshippers of the fire and the worshippers of the sun. So, much like the Vedic seers were. So, I have not touched upon all those things. So, in the brief span of time that I had, I think I have covered some of the salient ideas of Vipiwadiya, and many of his ideas are still very relevant. And he has touched upon certain ideas which look very trivial for us. For example, the importance of the family as the most important unit of society, and on the sacredness of the food that we must consume. So, the sacred feelings that we must have, the sacred attitude that we must have, even while consuming as small an activity as consuming food, and so on. And there are also many other ideas for reorganizing society via reorganizing our own life. The Indian world culture is indeed a worthy embodiment of many of his ideas, and must continue to broadcast his ideas. And there are many ideas that are, as I said, very valuable to us even to this day. Thank you very much.
I think it is befitting that we have a standing ovation for Dr. Kannan, as always. So it was sheer pleasure listening to him. In a very short span of time, he was able to eloquently take us through the journey of Vipiwadiya and his message. And he was able to sort of summarize his contributions to the society and his teachings through his 9 books, starting with Thus Have I Heard, Secret Doctrine of Levitsky, Aryan Path, the Manuskriti, which he quotes several times, and Vipiwadiya's own take on Bhagavad Gita, and also the similarities of various religions and its focus on the Chaturpurushartas, what we call as Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. So his own teachings on each one of those things, which has been laid out in his 50 plus articles in a very short span of 13 years, which he was able to do. So once again, on behalf of Indian Institute of World Culture, a very big thank you to take us through this journey, Dr. Kannan. So before we conclude with a vote of thanks, what I want to just do at this time is, I just want to tell that Indian Institute of World Culture is stepping into its platinum year, that is 75th year. And this wouldn't have been possible without the effective or the contributions of various volunteers, hundreds of them, starting with Vipiwadiya and his wife Sophia Wadia, were in fact the first volunteer couples for this institution, if I say so, is not an exaggeration. Now, they inspired quite a lot of volunteers, and the institution has been fortunate to have several of them dedicating their time and effort for this growth. So that tradition is still intact, and a small core committee formed at the start of this year, basically to revamp the children's library, was started. And to make it more vibrant and attractive to the younger audience, and to attract children, to get them back to the reading habit. So an effort was made, and the funds required for the revamping of the infrastructure was crowdsourced, in fact. And it was led by our executive committee member Ashish Krishnaswamy effectively. So I think a big round of applause is in place for this wonderful team. And the team not only has been involved in upgrading the facility, they have increased the student membership, conducting the summer camps after a gap of 15 years. So we attracted 70 odd kids in the first summer camp what we conducted, and the demand was such that we were forced to conduct the second one within 15 days, which we were very skeptical because we were restarting this activity after 15 years gap. So how the kids will take to it. More so recently, 2 days back, we had the Independence Day quiz, wherein this hall was insufficient to host the number of participants. So we had 100 plus kids and 200 parents accompanying them. It was fun to be in midst of the type of energy. So to take us through this journey of 8 months, where a lot of activities has taken place, I request Seema. There is a host of volunteers, so they are not aware. So I request Seema to take us through this 8 months journey. What this wonderful team has been able to contribute to this organization. So Seema.
Respected dignitaries, members of the executive committee, and all the guests that are here today taking your valuable time off.
I just want to make this announcement that they, in fact, it's our apologies to the team. They have made a PPT. In fact, we are not able to beam it across and show all the various photographs of children playing and also part of these activities. So apologies from our side, but she is going to run through the slides anyway.
A very good evening to you all. Mr. Venkatesh gave me a call a few days ago and he said, why don't you come and speak about everything that you've done in the children's library? And my question was, why? What's the objective? What do we want to do? So I said, well, we want to get inspired. And now as I recollect that statement and I try to fathom the audience that I see before me, I'm completely confused. Every single member in this room is at least a decade or two or three or four older than I am. And he has asked me to come and speak to inspire this crowd. I think it's totally the other way around. So, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನೆರೆದಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಗಣ್ಯರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸ್ಫೂರ್ತಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಮೇಲೆ ಸದಾ ಇರಲಿ ಅಂತ ಹಾರೈಸ್ತಾ ನಾವು ಈ 4-5 ತಿಂಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಚಿಲ್ಡ್ರನ್ಸ್ ಲೈಬ್ರರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೇನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಹಂಚ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಇಷ್ಟಪಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಸೊ ದೆರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ. ದೆರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ 5-year-old ಗರ್ಲ್ ಹೂ ವಾಸ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ ಬೈ, ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ವಿಸಿಟ್ ದ ಲೈಬ್ರರಿ ವೆರಿ ಆಫನ್. And there was a lot that she learned from this whole experience. A very regular visitor, a children's gang would come here and spend a lot of time here in the summer holidays, etc. Then the girl grew up and she stopped coming to the children's library. She used to borrow books from the main library. A lot of staff members that we have today have seen her from that age. And after that period, there came a time when this girl got married, had kids of her own, and she started coming to the children's library with her daughters, who were now 5 years old. And then when she saw the library, it was a completely changed place. It was quite a sleepy place. Even on a weekend, there would be about 4 or 5 kids hanging around in the library. Where were all the kids? They were no more with the books. They were with their phones. They were with their gadgets. They were with their tabs. So that made this girl think, we need to do something about getting the kids off their gadgets and back to the books. Fortunately for this girl, that very day in the library, she bumped into classmates who were, you know, classmates about 30 years ago. So they were all 10 years, 20 years as seniors. So they all got together and tried to figure out what we could do about the library. And ladies and gentlemen, I share the story with you so passionately because that little girl was me. And as we got together, you know, the gentlemen that I met at the library the other day, who were my seniors, Ashish and Shesha, and we got talking about what a wonderful place it was and we need to revive it, revamp it, do something about it. And fortunately for me, Ashish had also been thinking about it and he had assembled a fabulous team that I have in the audience today. So there is Ashwini, Shesha and Lata, who were all part of the team, who were thinking through the same thing. So I said, okay, let's get down to work and we'll make the library more attractive. So where do we start? We looked at all the racks and revamped it with those honeycomb racks that you see today in the children's library. We got tables that were really tiny, fit for 2 to 5 year olds, so that the furniture would make the place a little more attractive and the books more accessible to the kids. Well, the logistics was all sorted out with furniture. Next, the attention was books. So we looked at the books and thought how relevant it was to the younger kids. We went ahead and procured some new books that were absolutely resonant with the changing age groups that we had seen over the decades. So we procured about 100 books. We archived about 5,000 books. And when I say we, it was just this little team of 5 people some of them like me were working and didn't spend a whole lot of hours there, but our very dedicated volunteers like Ashwini, Lata, they did a lot of work. Physically, we lifted a lot of those books, archived it. We also wanted to make the lending process simple. So we barcoded about 16,000 books thanks to the efforts of Mr. Srinivas. And the numbers were very, very encouraging. 16,000 books barcoded, 5,000 books archived, 100 books procured. And we were wondering what else to do. We didn't have the kids still. We still had 4 or 5 people hanging around in the library. So we said, we need to do a membership drive. And we reached out to schools in the vicinity. Unfortunately for us, even when we went to a school like Chaitanya, which was right next door, they didn't seem to know about the Indian Institute of World Culture, which is right here, such a great institution. So the awareness was pretty low, and we thought the new age requires new age media as well to reach out to them. So we built out our whole presence on social media. We had a Facebook handle, an Instagram handle, etc., just to tell people that this place exists, it's a wonderful place, and here's what we're doing, and come to us. So it was not marketing, it was just outreach and awareness. So we did that, and we had about, you know, our expectation was, let's do about 50 members, please, by March 31st, because we want to inaugurate the library by then, and we don't want a blank hall. And to our surprise, there were 350 kids that turned up on the day of the inauguration. It was a fabulous success, and it was very encouraging for us as a team. So post this, our focus shifted to, well, we have the infrastructure, we have the books, how do we make the place more engaging? So we said, let's come up with a few events. And the volunteer team put together a fabulous list of events. Over the past 4 to 5 months, they've conducted about 20 events, cumulatively engaging more than about 1,000 kids. So our inauguration had a storytelling session by Trupti of Storywalas. We also had a quiz by Subbu Krishna Rao. This was on March 31st. We then had a movie screening on How to Train Your Dragon on 7th April. About 60 kids attended that event. Then we had something that was of a cultural flavor. So we did a Ramayana storytelling and coloring activity in the Manorama Hall by Mrs. Manjula Srikant. About 50 kids attended that event. They had a very beautiful aarti and then a coloring of characters from the Ramayana. Then we launched a book club. Pradyumna, who's here, did a fabulous job of facilitating those discussions for kids on what are their favorite books, what are their characters, what do they like. So it was a small attempt at reviving the joy of reading, even in that generation which was hooked to the tab and the phone. We then saw that one space we hadn't addressed was the connect with nature. So we said, let's do some nature walks. And Ashwini spotted a fabulous person called Mr. Raghottama from the Sikh Foundation, who came and did a nature walk right here at Krishna Rao Park, which is next door. We weren't aware of so many things. So he came and made the kids aware of the trees that are there. We did some charcoal painting with the trees. So that was another big successful event. Then we said, on the cultural front, we need to do something about the roots that we came from. Where is all the Sanskrit? Where is all the shlokas? And where are all the traditional games? So we put together a program called the Sanskrita Grishma Shibira, which was conducted by Aksharam. Then the book club continued to exist. We launched it in two formats. What Pratibha had launched earlier was for the seniors. We did a book club for the juniors, which had regular book reading activities. Once in a fortnight or so, we used to do a book read for the kids, and we had storytelling. So after the book club met with significant success, we moved our attention to crafts. And we did an origami event. Mr. Sita Ramo, who was fabulous at creating murals and origami, came and conducted that session for about 75 kids. And we then had a value education workshop. And what surprised me about some of these events was, you know, we've done this variety of events, and typically the most enrollments that we've seen are for events that focus on values. On a similar note, we did an event centering around the values of truth and courage. That met with a fabulous response as well. So it's heartening for me as a person of the mid-generation to see that there is still a focus amongst the parents on inculcating the right values in their kids. And I'm proud to say our institution is being fundamentally enabling that. Thanks. And then we had a number of book read and book club related sessions over the next few months. And we had some sessions on storytelling of Indian superheroes by Pradyumna. The session that I mentioned on Truth and Courage was also centered around a lot of Indian characters that have been forgotten unless they are revived by these kinds of sessions. We also had a session on traditional games and activities for children that was conducted by Bal Bharati around June. About 35-40 kids attended this event. Then we felt health was probably one area that we'd not addressed amongst this myriad of things that we were trying to do. So we hooked up with Isha Foundation, who came to our institute and did a session on Upa Yoga. So that was attended by about 30 kids. Then we also did a yoga for kids session, where we taught a number of postures as well as Surya Namaskar as a very fundamental exercise that they needed to learn. That was conducted by the Art of Living Foundation. So the point I'm trying to make is, we've had so many events over the course of these 4.5-5 months, and the momentum certainly needs to sustain. And as we did this, one thing we realized was a small team of 4 or 5 getting together over coffee and deciding what to do was just not enough. It was important to bring in some bit of institutional discipline and try to build out a team that could make this effort sustainable beyond just the 4 or 5 of us. So we sent out, we created a WhatsApp group and solicited volunteer efforts. And I'm extremely pleased to let you know that we have about 30 volunteers on that group today, at least about half of which are very, very active. So now that I've shared a little bit about how this all started, what we've done, I'd just like to part with a few words on what our learning has been through this extremely humbling journey. One realization has been that despite the fact that this institution is so old, so recognized, it continues to maintain its absolute distinction in the crowd of new age libraries like a just Books or an Easy Lib. They have so many new features. They lend books online. They come and deliver it to your house. We don't do any of that fancy stuff. We are still old school. But the library has extremely good resonance even with the newer generation. And that showed in the community spirit that came up in all of our events. The 350 member event that I just told you about during the inauguration, we had cupcakes being served to the kids. 350 cupcakes were all baked by home bakers, mothers who had children and who wanted to feed other children. Not a pie paid to any